a short time they did tour and they did do some concerts. Did that have an effect on the way concerts are performed today, or the way touring is done today, or not too much, or is that they
I don't
just
think so. Except for the fact that, well, I don't think this really matters. I mean, they did some big concerts, like Shea Stadium. And that wasn't so common. There was no rock festivals in those days, and outdoor concerts weren't, the facilities weren't good for it. But as soon as I say that, I mean, there were concerts at the Hollywood Bowl out in LA from back, at least in the 40s. So I don't think that was so revolutionary. The thing is, concerts sounded lousy in those days. I mean, the sound reproduction stuff was awful, and there was no way they could really ever reproduce their records or anything close to it on stage. And so they played at Shea Stadium, and everybody's screaming their heads off, and playing through these little PAs, and you can't even hear them. They couldn't hear each other. That's one reason they stopped touring. They'd look at each other and say, "We can play anything."
Yeah, right.
There's all these people screaming their heads off. Plus, I mean, after Revolver, there's no way they could do those songs on stage. Even if everybody's sitting quietly and the sound was perfect, they couldn't take that technology out of the studio at that time. So there was a lot of things that got them off the road. But I think what their big innovations were really in the recording studio, not in live playing. Live playing sounded pretty lousy up until about the 90s. It's incredible how long it took to get. And even now, you go to some concerts and they still sound terrible. Like, who's running the show? But at least now, if you go to a good show, it does sound good. And also, they can take so much out of the studio on them with. I mean, like when you go see U2, and there's the Edge playing his guitar, and there's like a whole symphony playing. Like, what's that? Well, it's a bunch of computers backstage. Well, they didn't have any of that in those days. So if you did some ambitious sounding thing, you weren't going to have that on stage, And then I think what made it persist, because Dylan got off the road at the same time for about 18 months. He didn't tour. Stones were stopped touring too. They were mostly dealing with drug trials. Not the kind you sign up for.
Yeah.
The kind where the law's after you. But there was a period there where like the biggest names in rock were just like not on the road. And then they came back. Dylan came back. Stones came back. But by the time the Beatles might have come back, they were already so mad at each other and ready to break up that they just didn't have a chance. And really, I mean, when the concert from Bangladesh came, it was in 1971, that was the first time that you really saw the Beatles again, but it was only, Ringo and George. Then they had Dylan, and he had, Badfinger and Eric Clapton and his buddies, basically. But once they had the animosity, Paul wanted to get back on the road. That's when they made the what became the Let It Be album. Was originally the session was called Get Back, and the idea was let's get back, to our roots and let's do a tour. And then that soon became like, no, we don't want to do this. Well, let's do a TV show, and that didn't even work. So finally, had that thing from the Let It Be movie where they play on the roof of the
Savile Row studio.
And that's about as close as they got to live performing, just that brief thing.
Yeah, it's a shame that the police took him off there. But George Harrison, he was once quoted as saying this in 69. I just can't get any complete impression of Abbey Road, meaning the album. With Pepper and even the White Album, I get an overall image of the complete product. But with this one, I'm still at a loss. I think it's a bit like Revolver, but I still feel very abstract about it. I just can't see it as a whole entity yet. To me, listening to Abbey Road is a bit like listening to someone else. It doesn't feel like the Beatles. So I asked this question too when I interviewed Dr. Thompson up at Skidmore, and I'd like to ask you too what your impression of those three albums are, namely Sgt. Pepper's and the White Album and Abbey Road, and would you agree with Harrison's assessment there?
No, I don't agree with him at all. Lennon also had some bad words for Abbey Road. I think, was that from 69, the quote?
Yes.
Yeah, so see, they were in such a place then. They didn't like each other, and neither Harrison or Lennon liked McCartney. And a lot of the impetus for Abbey Road was McCartney. Look, I mean, it's got some of Harrison's best songs on Abbey Road. So, what's he talking about? And Lennon said, "Well, I don't like that suite, with all those little bits and pieces of songs. I like the first side. I don't like the second side." Well, that suite was one of the coolest things the Beatles ever did.
Yeah.
So I think you got to that was there in the midst of emotional turmoil, and we don't have to pay attention to it. All three of those records are real classics. I'm glad they made Abbey Road, because otherwise, Let It Be which was actually the last record released, that would have been their last record. That was kind of a mess. I mean, it's kind of groovy because it's the Beatles, and even when they're making a mess, it's neat. You know, like even Revolution Number 9 is neat.
Right.
You know, but Abbey Road is a masterpiece. You know, and it was a good way for them to go out, really. But no, I mean, when they made Sgt. Pepper's, that really did kind of change the world. It was really, really influential. Came out summer 67. There was nowhere. I was living in Algeria at the time. In those days, I mean, that was about as far from the world as you could get. And I mean, just like not even in Algiers, but out, just out. and like, what's playing is Sgt. Pepper's.
Right.
You know, it was unbelievable. You know, people had, and there was not a radio or anything, but people had brought the record in, and it was making the rounds, and that's what you'd hear at parties, and everything. It was like. And this the ambition of that record caught a lot of people's fancy, you know. All of a sudden, you know, it was like, and there was a lot more like that going on. You'd had Dylan's Highway 61 Revisited, Blonde on Blonde, big ambitious things. The Doors first album that had some really unusual things for the time, but you know. Now you had the leading rock band in the world saying, okay, this is what albums are now. And after that, you get, you know, all these one record after record from then on, Let It Bleed by the Stones and Electric Ladyland by Hendrix. So they're just these incredible artworks, you know. Because before, always the 45 single was the main rock vehicle. Now it's clear the album is it. And it just sort of, besides the music on it and all the innovative stuff, and the interesting style mixtures and everything, just the influence that it had across the board was so powerful. And then they kind of, you know, had a little bit of a glitch with Magical Mystery Tour, but that was mostly, you know, a collection of singles and stuff. It was full of good songs. It wasn't really conceived as like a whole album, like Rubber Soul, Revolver, and Sgt. Pepper's had been. But then they got their thing together and did the White Album, which is one of the coolest things ever. It's just, talk about a mess, it's like, it was rambles because it's two whole albums, right? And it just rambles from thing to thing to thing. And just like, just if you just pick McCartney tracks, like a really pretty song, Blackbird, and what's the other one?
I Will. Yeah.
And then contrast that with, you know, Helter Skelter, Why Don't We Do It in a Road, you know. Really hard, edgy rock and this really sweet stuff. And the same thing with Lennon's Julia,
yeah.
You know, and then Bungalow Bill, Looking Through a Glass Onion, crazy stuff, you know. And then their normal crazy stuff, you know. Don't Pass Me By and Oh Blood Be Ill Done, Back in the USSR, and some kooky stuff. And then the Experimental Revolution Number 9. I mean, you just, and that, and again, influential, that record when it came out, this is how cool Top 40 radio was in those days. DJs would play the entire two records over and over, including Revolution Number 9. And they'd say, the Beatles' new record is out, the Beatles' new record is out, and the radios would just crank it all day long. So cool. So that was a total high, and then but then there was the big worry that they knew they hated each other, they were going to break up anytime.